border between France and Britain. Luckily there's a sort of sea there, which helps affairs as well. So that's one area, and every country has the right of sovereignty, that if a new move comes along, a country can say, we invoke our sovereignty, we don't want to do that. That makes things much more difficult than having one federal union. Minuses, loss of sovereignty, loss of democratic authority and so forth, these things, artificial policies, which we'll come on to in a little bit later, and financial constraints in monetary policy now that the ECB has been formed, and I'll deal with that a little bit more later, the same with these points here. Economic performance is artificially boosted with subsidies and loans, so that Greece or Ireland or some of the other countries may feel, actually we're doing pretty well. Our economy is doing well, there's lots of money going around, property prices are going up, this all looks very good. But it's actually artificially boosted by money coming in, not stimulated by real economic growth. And the suffering then comes later. As with every bubble, it has to burst. Now, this is something, if you go out on the street in pretty much every European country and say, what are the main institutions of the European Union? Most people wouldn't know all of these. They'd know the European Parliament, they'd know that the heads of government meet, but they probably wouldn't know much about all of these others. The European Commission is the executive, and this is the very bulky part. It's supposed to be audited by the European Court of Auditors, but the audit of the European institutions is 10 years behind. So imagine if the crisis began in 2008, that's 5 years ago. The auditing of the European accounts is 5 years behind that. So it's a real mess, and this is something that people complain about, that you're giving away the authority to run the budget to an unaccountable authority. The Council of the European Union, you have a lower house and an upper house. The upper house is a shifting house, because if you're dealing with industrial policy, it will be the industry or commerce ministers that meet. If you're dealing with defence, it's the defence ministers that meet from all the 27 countries. If it's agriculture, it's all the agriculture ministers that will meet. So that's a very different situation from the upper house here or the upper house in Britain or the United States.